It is my great pleasure to welcome you to the ACM A.M. Turing Lecture. This annual presentation is delivered by the winner of the ACM A.M. Turing Award, which is named for the great British mathematician and computer scientist Alan M. Turing, the originator of the Turing test, and whose 100th birthday we've been celebrating, had quite a big celebration at ACM about 2 weeks ago in San Francisco. The Turing Award is often referred to as the Nobel Prize of Computing, as the most prestigious a computer science can receive, and it carries with it a $250,000 prize generously provided by Intel and Google. This year's recipient of the ACM Turing Award and our lecturer this morning is Judea Pearl, Professor of Computer Science and Statistics at the University of California in Los Angeles. He received this honor in recognition of his fundamental contribution to artificial intelligence as a result of his development of a calculus for probabilistic and causal reasoning. So you can see it quite fitting that he addressed this audience at this conference, since one of the true pioneers in advancing both the science and the art of artificial intelligence. And I don't use the term art loosely, because if you know any of Professor Pearl's works or books, you'll know that he's as much a philosopher as a scientist. The subject for his talk this morning is the mechanization of causal inference, a mini Turing test and beyond. And it is my privilege to introduce Judea Pearl. Judea.
Thank you, Kelly, for the wonderful introduction. I'm very glad to be here. I did request to deliver this Turing lecture at this forum because I felt it is important that I will tell you, not only share the glory of this award, which of course you deserve, being with me at the early stage of this game, but also because I think you deserve to hear a progress report about what happened in this adventure since we last played in the sandbox and we built those castles together. Also, I think it's important that I pay tribute to this organization for nurturing my work when it was not exactly fashionable. And actually, some people say it was controversial or say mischievous. I would like to thank all of you for, number one, being partners of the developments of the things I'm going to talk about, colleagues, co-authors, co-principal investigators, and students, and reviewers. I don't know if I should thank my reviewers, but I should. No, that's kind of, I noticed that some of my three most important work were published in the proceedings of the AAAI, so I would like to start with that. And my first slide is about AAAI is a breeding ground for some of those mischievous ideas that I talked. One is what took place in 1982. If I'm sure that not many of you remember that trip on a boat in Pittsburgh, and that was where my first paper on belief propagation in trees was published. And then I noticed that one of the first papers with the Duke calculus was published in the AAAI in Seattle in 1994. It was a paper together with Adnan Darwish, But you see the symbol here, do A appear in the title, and it wasn't rejected. I'm sure that it wouldn't have been published in any other conference proceedings, maybe in statistics or in any other field. And the third that I'd like to mention is the same conference, Seattle of 1994, was the paper with Balki on probabilistic evaluation of counterfactual queries. I choose those three because they are the titles of the three-layer hierarchy of causal reasoning that we have today. They established as a very, very solid kind of hierarchy that is rarely mixed in the sense that you can syntactically tell what a sentence is, whether it is probabilistic, whether it is causal or counterfactual. But this is not a lecture about my work. It's a lecture about Turing. So let me start with Turing and his Turing test. As we all read the paper in the Mind magazine in 1950, and a test that I think is an engine of much of the work that is done in AI. The Turing answer to this question of can computer think was very simple. Yes, if it acts like it thinks. And what one mean by act is that it answers non-trivial questions about a story, a topic, or a situation. And I'm with the question of what non-trivial is, and I did not take a topic or a story, but a modality. So I'll show you many of us working on a mini Turing test in various fields, but I consider the work in causal reasoning to be to partition the field, or to take a task which is unique in terms of the modalities used rather than the domain. So here's what Turing described a hypothetical conversation with the machine. First was the question about a sonnet, about poetry. And the answer, of course, is evasive. But still, it has some human element to it. I never could write poetry. The second answer is about arithmetic. Second question is about arithmetic. Can you add that and that? And the answer is, of course, also human. You pause for 30 seconds, and then you give the answer. So this is also a very simple domain. And then Turing said, let's look at chess. And do you play chess? Yes. I have a king on my K1, and you no other pieces. You have only king at K6 and rook on root 1. It is your move. What do you play? And of course, the machine answers after a pause, checkmate. Okay, so these were the three questions exemplified in Turing's first paper. Narrow domains, arithmetic, poetry, and chess, reasonable answers. But then in chapter 7 of that book, Barbara Gross showed me, he talks about the child machine. So he goes further and says, he talks about essentially machine learning. Why should we think about adult? Why don't we start with a child machine? It should be easier, is it? Because the child does not need as much background as we expect adults to have. Our hope is that there is so little mechanism in the child brain that something like it can be easily programmed. I think too many underestimate the role that vision and motor actions play in our high-level intelligence. All the metaphors taken from the child world are playing a tremendous role in the child's ability to handle mathematics and I think student Turing underestimate the difficulty of starting with a child brain. But then he went to machine learning, and he made some revolutionary statement about the connection between machine learning and evolution. And he said the survival of the fittest is a slow method for measuring advantages. The experimenter, I mean the programmer, by exercise of intelligence should be able to speed it up. How? By creating artificial mutations where they are needed. If he can trace a cause for some weakness, he can probably think of a kind of mutation which will improve it. And that was, I think, it's a great vision here, anticipating the ability of a child. His idea was that the programmer would be able to trace weaknesses of the program to where it counts and create the mutation. But then the question is, why should the machine have a blueprint of itself and be able to pinpoint the root cause of the weakness and then change the priority among the competing computational resources? I will now then explain to you why I chose the causal reasoning to be a domain deserving of the title mini Turing test. So imagine that you have here the experiment room with the partition, the famous partition between the interrogator and the machine. And the input would be a story about a record, a known domain. And then the questions will be limited to three types. What is, what if, and why? And the answer expected is, I believe that so-and-so will be the consequence. And here the story, I used it many times in my book of 1988 and then in Causality. The story is that you get out of your house, you see the pavement maybe wet or dry, maybe slippery or not. You are in a dry or wet season, and you suspect that if the pavement is wet and it either rained or the sprinkler was on. A very simple story, five binary variables, highly connected to your everyday experience. And then the task is, you tell the story of the machine and make the machine, program the machine to answer simple question about three types of modalities. And here they are. Here one, if the season is dry and the pavement is slippery, did it rain? And you expect an answer, unlikely. It's more likely the sprinkler was on, with a very slight possibility that it is not even wet. There could be some other reasons for why it is slippery. That is the kind of answer you expect. On the basis of what? The way you program the story into the machine, and the way you program in the relationship between various likelihood of events. So this is an example of expectation, evidence, observations, and what is likely as a result of that. Then comes the question about, but what if we see that the sprinkler is off? And you expect an answer, then it is more likely that it rained. It's reasonable, okay? It's explaining away. And now comes the question about actions. Do you mean that if we actually turn the sprinkler on, the rain will be less likely? And you want the machine to say, no, there's a difference between seeing and doing. No, no, the likelihood of rain would remain the same, but the pavement would surely get wet. Now comes the question of counterfactual nature. Suppose we see that the sprinkler is on and the pavement wet. What if the sprinkler were off? I'll later apologize why I'm so hung up on counterfactual. But first, I would like you to answer the questions instead of the machine. What I expect the machine to say is, the pavement would be dry because the season is likely dry. Namely, you take the observation here that the sprinkler is on, and you infer, oh, it must be a dry season. Then, if the sprinkler were off, the past remained the same. What changes the future? So the answer should be because the season is likely dry and the payment is right. Okay, this is a kind of question-answer sessions we expect on a very, very toy-like problem. We all remember the several argument of the Chinese room. It says, no, just answering this question doesn't mean that the machine thinks, because here is imagine that the machine answers questions in Chinese based on a rule book. Okay, where every sentence in English or in Chinese has the answer printed there in Chinese or in English. And it doesn't mean that the machine understands Chinese just because it looks up the answer in the book. Well, what Searle has overseen is the fact that there aren't enough molecules in the universe to make up the book. Okay. Because the number of, if you just count the number of sentences, possible combinations there, somebody made the calculation that there aren't enough molecules in the universe. So you said, so what? Just because you have a combinatorial difficulty, the machine thinks? Yes. The answer is yes. Because when you have such a problem to overcome, the only way to overcome it is by taking advantages of the constraints. And understanding the constraint is what we mean by understanding it. It is a necessary component in understanding. So even for the sprinkler example, now if you take just, for the sake of argument, 10 binary variables, okay, and you count the number of entries in the table that you would need, if you just do it by a Searle's Chinese book method, you'll come out quickly to the number of 1,000 entries just for the probability, multiply by another 1,000 just to get for every action, and then when you go to the counterfactual, you have another 1,000. You have already a billion long table for this simple pavement story. Okay. So, because you have many, many constraints among those modalities of what happens, what is likely if I do what, or hadn't I done something, or hadn't an event occurred. And even children answer those questions quite intelligibly. And the question is how? The next question I have to is to explain to you why I think that causal conversation is important and why we should exercise the Turing test on it. First, there are many Turing tests. Okay. Turing started with poetry, arithmetic, and chess. You can imagine that some built a Turing test for stock market. I think it's one of the easiest ones to do for the stock market because there aren't any constraints, there aren't any expertise around. It's very much like a poetry. But why do I go to causal reasoning? Number one is because it's so pervasive in human cognition and human ethics. I have a few slides on that. And it's so deeply entrenched in the development of children. And the second one, it is the building block, I think, of scientific thinking. And the third reason is because it's important for robotic. And the third occupied maybe more than 5 or 10 years of my life is that there are so many customers. There are data intensive scientific applications around that could benefit from any insight on causal reasoning. There are, I said, thousands of hungry and aimless customers. They're not hungry in terms of being poor, they're well endowed. All the pharmaceutical companies are part of that customer field, but they're hungry for ideas because they are aimless, because causal reasoning has not been formalized, and any insight that we get by trying to make a robot understand cause and effect is immediately translatable to a method that could save millions of dollars in those fields. Okay. Let me start with the human cognition and ethics. I like to start with Adam and Eve. Where else do you start? And you can see that immediately when God asked Adam, hey, did you eat from that tree? Adam asks, he doesn't say yes or no. I mean, facts are for the gods. Excuses are for men. She handed me the fruits and I ate. Okay? And Eve, of course, is no less expert in causal explanations. And she said, the serpent, don't blame me. The serpent deceived me and I ate. So that is how entrenched it is, the need to pass the buck to somebody else is very deeply entrenched in human cognition. And then it's a basis for our sense of justice. You all remember when God told Abraham that he's about to destroy the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. And Abraham said, hey, are you about to smite the righteous with the wicked? You can't do that. Hashofet kol ha'aretz lo yaseh mishpat, excuse my Hebrew, but that's exactly how it sounded there about 3,000 years ago. Hashofet kol ha'aretz lo yaseh mishpat. What if there were 50 righteous men in the city? Here you have the first counterfactual in the Bible. What if there were 50? And look what God says. If I find in the city of Sodom 50 good men, I will pardon the whole place for their sake. Do you think Abraham gave up at that point? No. He goes down and said, what about 45? I mean, are you going to make a big fuss for five people? And God says, no, I ain't going to destroy it. Then he goes down to 40, and then 30, and 20, and 10, and you know what happened. The rest is history, and the question, of course, what is Abraham trying to, what kind of game? Did Abraham doubt the ability of God to count? or to distinguish a righteous from the wicked? No. Abraham was the first scientist. He tried to find a general rule. Where is the threshold? The general rule for collective punishment. In that sense, he was the first scientist. Because what is science all about? Trying to find the general rule, not about this specific event. So here I go to science to prove to you that counterfactuals are indeed the basis for science. We all used to do questions in physics, like Hooke's law that tells you that the length of a string y equals a constant, I'll take 2, times the weight. So y is equal to 2x, and x is equal to 1 kilogram. Figure out what the length of the string is, and you think it's all arithmetic, right? And here the solution. You just solve 2 equations with 2 unknown. And the question is this system of equation equivalent to that one? According to my rule, my book of algebra, 2 systems of equations are equivalent if they preserve solutions. And these 2 preserve solutions. But are they equivalent? You say, of course not. Because the left system of equation can answer questions that the right one does not. So they're not equivalent. Here's a question. Here's a third alternative. I'll tell you why I put it there. Because the left set of equations can answer a counterfactual question. Had x been 3, y would be 6, which translates into, if we raise the weight to 3, what would be the length? It would be 6, right? And how do we do that? We wipe out the equation x equal to 1. We replace it by x equal to 3. And we solve a new system of equations, which is modified now by the new information. And we give you the answer. Zoop, it's y is equal to 6. Why didn't we do it here? It's equivalent, right? I wipe out x equal to half y, replace it with x equal to 3, and I get y is equal to 4. That's the wrong one, right? So every child in high school, when he or she solves physics problems, are engaging themselves in counterfactual reason. They know which equation to wipe out and which equation to keep. They keep the one that conveys a generic rule, and they wipe the ones that are either boundary conditions or that they are subject to the antecedent of the counterfactual. So, and they get some. If this is the case, then the equality sign that we saw before was not really an algebraic equality. It was really a convenient replacement for a computer programming language sign of assignment. It imagined that nature, before determining the length of the spring, nature looks around for all variables that might possibly affect the length, looks at the weight and say, ah, that is the one, consult the weight on the spring and determine the value of the length. So this is the conception of physics. Nature looks at variables, goes to some process, and then assign value on other variables. If that is so, I mean, it requires a different kind of algebra because it involves wiping of equations, and we signify that with in the graph instead of the assignment symbol with the arrow. That is the meaning of the arrows in the structural graph, in the causal graph. It's a description of the recipes of the strategy of nature. Okay, so I convince you now that physics is all about counterfactuals. I remember a conversation that I have with someone who said, you are kidding me. It couldn't be. Yeah. Anyhow, that's my history. The role of counterfactual and causation in human reasoning has not escaped many philosophers. Already the time of the Greek in 430 BC, Democritus said, I would rather discover one causal relationship than be king of Persia. King of Persia at that time was not exactly a dangerous occupation like it is today. And the Hume, of course, looked at that with a puzzle and said, what is this idea of causation? I got to solve it. And he came out with that, with the conception that causation is not a gift of the gods, but something that we learn from experience. And here is this famous paragraph. We remember to have seen that species of objects called flame, and to have felt the species of sensations we call heat. Without any further ceremony, we call the one cause and the other effect. So it's a matter of determining regularity in nature that makes us come up with a label cause. There are difficulties to that, of course, but the idea that all philosophers have stumbled on the difficulty of explaining what causes brings us to ask, what gives us the audacity here in AI to think that we can add another iota to this long debate? And the answer is simply that we don't have the luxury to philosophize. We need to build robots that understand what went wrong in the laboratory or the kitchen. And we need to, and if they don't learn it by themselves, we need to at least to have the option of teaching them the cause-effect relationship in the environment by mentoring or by when spending the time, if we have an understanding of what's going on, to sit down and teach them what we know so that they can act properly and answer queries about cause-effect relationship. And this is not a trivial thing, because you might say, because now the puzzle that philosophers have faced translate into engineering problems. The question of how do we acquire causal information from the environment is translated into how would a robot acquire causal information from the environment. And the question of how we people come up with a label cause and effect translate into how should a robot use causal information received from its creator programmer to understand or to answer queries properly. And the second one, although it looks trivial, it's not really trivial. Because if you just follow the rules, you get some unexpected result. If you tell the, if the input is, if the grass is wet, then it rained. If you break this bottle, the grass will get wet. You don't want an output such as if we break the bottle, then it rained. So just rule chaining is not going to do the work for you. You need something more. And what is that something more? Before we get there, let me give an outline of what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to talk about the three hierarchy, the three-level hierarchy. The questions which ranges from what if I see, this is a probability and beliefs, what if I do, and then what if I did things differently, which is a counterfactual. And if you want to decorate them with probability, how likely the answer is to be, but that's not essential. What if, what is, what if, and why? Now I'll give you a field report of the trip or the journey that we took from the old days of Bayesian network to causal and counterfactual. Okay. We have to understand the distinction and the mental barrier that stand in our way, and I'll talk about that. We have to talk about what makes a causal model as opposed to something else. How is it being tested? And the two are connected. If a model has a testable implication, then you can hope to discover it from, or learn it. A model that doesn't have any testable implication cannot be discovered from data. So the two are connected. Then I'll talk about three applications. Effect of interventions, the evolution of the due calculus, and the algorithmization of counterfactuals. And then I'll talk about applications, okay? These are the three tasks that were relatively completely solved and theoretically. And the application will involve evaluation of plans and policies. Second, mediation, distinguishing between direct and indirect cause. And the third one is generalization, which, which we are going to talk Elias is going to talk to you today in afternoon. So here is statistics proper. This is the paradigm that overrules, that overrides statistical thinking and also machine learning. The idea that someplace behind the scenes there is a Santa Claus called the joint probability distribution, that occasionally, when he or she is gracious enough, spits out data, and then our job is to infer properties of the Santa Claus, namely Q of P, some aspect of the joint distribution function from the data. Estimate the mean, or come up with a classifier, or decide whether customers who bought product A would also buy product B. You see, that kind of question is neat and well formalized because it can be neatly encapsulated in the language of probability theory. you even have a short sentence. Find the probability of B given A, conditional probability, coming all the way from 250 years ago, Reverend Bayes. Okay, there's nothing to it except the complexity of the problem. Q can be very, very complex. A joint distribution can be defined on many, many variables, okay, continuous and binary and so on. So it's not easy, but the paradigm is the same. Causal reasoning deals with a different paradigm. Okay. You ask a question, for instance, infer whether customers who bought A would buy product B if we double the price. So here we come, get up in the morning and we anticipate, we become whimsically greedy. Just wonder what will happen if we raise the price. And if we ask a question, what will be the probability of B given A, and given that we do something that perhaps wasn't even done before, we double the price. It's not even an aspect of P, because it's different than the conditional probability on P being double. Okay? It's a difference between seeing the price doubled and making it double. Here's the counterfactual question. Had we doubled the price, okay, it is not aspect or property of the Santa Claus, Mr. P. So what is it? It's a property of a data generating model that behind this, the joint probability. Yeah, the joint probability spits out data. Yes, we get those samples, and we need to infer some property, but of what? Not of P, but of the data generating model. This is the invariant strategy of nature that I talked to you before, or sometimes called mechanism, recipe, law, protocol, or counterfactual, by which nature assigns values to variables in the analysis. And the trick for us, definitely, it is a torture for statisticians, but it's a trick. It takes a little leap of imagination to think nature rather than experiment or rather than measurements. It is a traumatic experience for people outside artificial intelligence. So I would like you to be aware of that if you ever talk to an outsider. Once we go there, let's generalize it. Let's imagine that the whole world is just a collection of spring. So it is fueled by a collection of functions that assign values to variables here. Every VI in this trillion and one different variables is being assigned a value that is a function of the other variables in the system. Some of them are exogenous. You don't care about the explanation. You care about the effect. And some are endogenous. And our job is to now encode this on the machine so that the machine can answer reasonable and plausible answers to our questions, which were very reasonable. What if you see the sprinkler is on? Here's a typical equation from those FIs in a linear case, okay? Y is assigned a value. After nature spent some time, maybe a billionth of a second, looking at X, multiplying by constant, adding to it some noise, and deciding that Y deserves a value small y. Great work, ladies nature. And our job is to uncipher or decipher the mapping of nature, but that is very ambitious. At least we should be able to answer counterfactual queries if we have data from nature. We're all familiar with the circuit diagram. This is an oracle for counterfactual, because if you look at the circuit, you can answer counterfactual questions. What if I were to change this OR gate with an AND gate? Or what if I were to connect this Y to a power supply of 3.5 volts. Even though the designer of the circuit never anticipated such crazy questions and such crazy event like connecting it to a power supply, okay? The engineer glancing at the circuit has the ability to contemplate the answer and do it correctly. So where it all comes from? It's coming from some fundamental properties of this collection of functions. The fundamental one, from which everything else eventually derives, is that if you happen to have, you be lucky and your equations are recursive, no cycles there, and the disturbances happen to be independent of each other, then regardless of the functions that you have there, and regardless of the distributions of disturbances, you can say something about the probability distribution of what you observe. So the structure of that collection of springs determines something very basic in your distribution function, which is a product form, which is conditional independencies. Okay. And from that comes the next corollary is your ability to answer questions about interventions. Once you have this product, if somebody asks you, and what if I do an action, you just simply take a truncated product. It's called manipulation theorem or truncated factorization. It's the same product form, but you delete from the product those variables which were forced to a constant because they do not no longer listen to their parents. Here's our sprinkler example again. If you have before you act, you have decomposition according to this diamond shape, and this written down by the product that you find there, a product of a variable given its parent. A variable given its parent, nothing special about it, but if you do take an action, like turn the sprinkler on, you delete that process from the discussion because Mr. Sprinkler no longer listens to the season. Mr. Sprinkler becomes enslaved to your muscles when you turn it on. So it's replaced by a constant. And let me see now. So I have 12 minutes left. I'll go a little faster than I anticipated. But you are so attentive. I hate to disappoint you. I have so many nice stories to tell you. It was a nice journey, I must tell you. Okay, so we have now a formalism for action. And it didn't germinate in AI. It originated with economist Havelmo in 1943. Had the idea of how would you model government intervention in the economy, like fixing price or imposing taxes. And he has the idea that you have an equation there and the government does something to keep the price constant here, Ri the constant, add to it another force to balance other forces so that Ri will remain constant, okay? Later on it came, was replaced by Stott and Wald into wipe out an equation, replace it with a constant, and then Spiritus and Glimo translated into a graphical surgery procedure that you wipe out the errors going into the manipulated variable, and that led to the truncated factorization. And I took it very seriously and said, no, we have a new calculus here that deserve algebraic support, and translated that into a do calculus, and then we applied that to counterfactuals. So that is the evolution of these ideas. I'll go a little, and now we have unification with the Niemann-Rubin camp in statistics, which also are handling causality by counterfactuals. So how counterfactuals are being handled? What is the model for counterfactual? It's very simple. You mutilate your model to take care of the antecedent of the counterfactual, and you solve the equation in the mutilated model. There's nothing else to it. Embarrassingly simple. From this you can get, and this is I'm just expressing symbolically what I said here in the English sentence, and you have become, you are in possession now of a calculus, because you have semantic for joint counterfactual. For any sets of variables, you can find a joint probability of the y taking a value small y, had x been small x, and simultaneously z taking value small z, had w taking anything you can think, any sentence you have now the semantics for finding the probability of that joint convoluted sentence. It rarely appears in the sentence, but we have to cope with. Specifically, sentences involving actions with the do, and sentences involving attribution. What the likelihood that a patient would be alive today had he not taken the drug, given that in fact he's dead and he took the drug. So that's a sentence in the language. The semantic is there. If you have the model, compute. Everybody knows how to solve equations, right? The semantic is extremely simple. And Joe Halperin, my student Galax, came up with a complete axiomization of that. Why do we need axiomization? So that if anybody said he can do counterfactual differently or very, we just compare the axioms and say, no, it's a logical equivalent. the working horse is a composition which tells you that if you do something that would have occurred anyhow, you haven't done a thing. That is essentially the sentence that says that our world is closest to our world than any other possible world. You go to the possible world interpretation of this. I'll give you an example of what you can do with it. Okay. A bunch of equations, you think the nature works like that. Okay. First question you have to ask yourself, is it testable? Does it have any testable implication? As I said before, if it doesn't have testable, you cannot learn it. Okay. And the idea here is very simple. Everything that we did with Bayesian net, translate now into causal Bayesian net, and the disapparation gives you a finite set of testable implications. Just look at the missing arrows. Everyone carries promise for a test. And if it fails, the model is wrong. What else it can do for you? It can answer intervention. It's oracle for intervention. So if you have a question such as, find the average causal effect of X and Y, given that you can measure variables W1, Z1, and so on, and the answer, can you do it without manipulation, just by observation? And the answer is yes. If you can adjust for this variable, age, ethnicity, and others, okay, then you are guaranteed that you can answer the queries without bias, by simple adjustment, by regression. But of course, it built on the assumptions encoded in the graph. Each one is missing link is an assumption of causal nature, not of statistical nature. So let's take another example. Here's a difficult one. Suppose we wish to estimate the average causal effect, and which variable should be, and we are allowed only one measurement. It turns out that this one will do the job for you. For those of you who know the front door criterion, this is a front door criterion. Okay, here's an example which is highly applicable. You are in a sports medicine business, and you wonder whether warm-up is a cause of injury or prevents injuries in the game. It's an extremely important question for our society, for our culture, right? Well, here's a measurement you can take. But the previous injuries, team aggressiveness, and so on, which one would you measure? Each one takes a lot of dollars to measure. And the answer is given to you automatically. Thou shalt measure this, and you're okay. Thou shalt not measure that, because you would get biased. Thou shalt measure that, fine. Here is another alternative, and so on. So you can pick up the measurements according to their cost and their reliability. And here's the engine that drives that answering mechanism. 4 minutes. What one can accomplish in 4 minutes, you will see. So here's the engine, three rules that takes in a graph and apply them repeatedly and give you the answer. Here's an example. Does smoking cause cancer? The question is given to you with a causal a symbol. A red symbol is if I do. We don't have doing. We cannot conduct randomized experiments on smokers. So we have to do it analytically. We apply the rules and one after the other. Zoop, we got rid of all the purple symbols. If we get rid of the red symbols, it turns out you can do it by hands-off passive observation, and you can answer the question. Yes or no, this is how much smoking causes cancer. What else can it do for you? Let's skip that. Find equivalent model. Identify counterfactual queries. Mediation, which I will have time to talk about, I'm sure. Find causes of effect. Explanation and transportability, which Elias is going to talk to you about with his poster at 4 p.m. today, namely generalizing what you learn from one domain into another domain in which you cannot conduct any experiments. Okay. Counterfactual is very interesting because philosophers have gone through a great pain and to understand why we form consensus about counterfactuals. Here is a typical example. If I tell you this couple of sentences, you'll tell me yes, yes, yes on the first one and no, no, no on the other one. And people normally in our culture form a consensus. How can we do that? And that was a puzzle for many philosopher Hume tried to explain causes in terms of counterfactual, and David Lewis tried to explain. The puzzle that I faced was different. How come they try to define, how come he don't try to define counterfactual in terms of causes, but the other way around? Are counterfactual less problematic? Apparently so, because we do form consensus on counterfactual, and even these two pillars of philosophy try to define causes in terms of counterfactual. It means that we do have here a counterfactual engine that is swift and reliable, and we form consensus because we share the architecture of this engine. So this is an AI problem, not a philosophy problem. Indeed, what Lewis came up with was a possible world semantics for counterfactual, which relies on assessing how close is the world after Nixon presses the button to a world in which we are alive, as opposed to a world in which Nixon pressed the button and somebody disconnected the wires, okay? That is a typical question in philosophy. Assessment how similar worlds are in this structural world, you don't rely on similarity among worlds. You rely on equations which are common, equations of physics, and mutilating those equations. I will not have time to talk about counterfactual triumph, which is the ability to distinguish between direct and indirect effects. And it's important because we talk like that, we send people to prison because they are directly responsible for murder or only indirectly responsible. So it matters very much in our society, and it gives us the ability to answer questions about different kind of intervention. Intervention where you able and disable certain mechanisms rather than fixing variables like I talked before. I will skip that. It's a booming field now in statistics and other areas about direct and indirect effects called mediation analysis. Okay? And the impetus for that was counterfactual. We were able to express the idea of indirect effect by counterfactual like you see it here. See, what is the definition of indirect effect? Is the expected change in output when we keep the input constant but change the mediator by how much? But what he would have gotten, by the very would have gotten, had the input changed. Okay? So it's a nested counterfactual. That is now a definition accepted when you have indirect effect. It involves no fixing of variables. Yeah, so I consider it a triumph. But I'm going on to the next triumph, which is right here, transportability. And I say it's a trap because here the Duke calculus appeared like from the ashes. We didn't expect it to be to reveal its potency in an area like that, which has very little to do with the intervention. Imagine that you want to transfer relationship to learn from experiments to a different environment in which no experiments are conducted. So we can think about training a robot in the cockpit and moving him or her to another environment where only observations are allowed, but no experiments. How much of the causal knowledge that the robot acquired in the cockpit can be transferable? And we want a logical answer, yes or no. A certain relationship is or is not transferable, given what we know about the two environments. Okay? And this has, surprisingly, gotten a complete answer. Elias is going to talk about completeness theorem. Okay? A complete answer, which means you cannot do any better. This means all the people working on machine transfer, domain transfer, they call it, okay, will get stumbled in those cases where our answer says it cannot be done. They may not know why, or the practitioner may be surprised. It doesn't work. But so we are striving to getting a yes or no answer, given that we make a certain assumptions about disparities and commonalities between the two environments. I think I'm closer to the end. I have here 5 seconds. I do have. Okay. So here are all the nice examples you're going to miss. The most important one is that one. You give me a graph, you signify there where the two domains are different or suspected to be different, and I'll tell you about a certain relationship, yes or no, it can or it cannot be transferred. And if it does, then here the green one gives you the measurement you should take in the experimental domain, and the blue tells you, or the purple tells you, measure you take in the target population where you don't allow any measurement, and this is how you combine them together, okay, to get the correct unbiased results when it's done. So the completeness is 4 o'clock, bing, bing, bing. Oh, and I didn't talk about my new thing, which is meta-analysis, in which the big data comes to play here. Imagine that you have data coming from thousands of hospitals in the United States or worldwide, okay, each one conducted under different conditions, okay, with different populations, okay, and you need to combine them all to come up with an answer to a query in another environment with no measurements is allowed. All you know is the structure. Okay. Can you do it or can't you do it? Okay. Yes or no answer, and if you can, how? So I go through the how in many slides here, which you have to skip, and believe me, there is a method here, and there is a lot of work to be done here in terms of decomposing the relationship into side relationship to be able to pick up from every study the juice, the commonalities, and to put them together and to come out with an unbiased estimate. The conclusions hit me in the face. The counterfactual are the building blocks of scientific thoughts on free will and moral behavior and algorithmization of counterfactual has benefited several problems in the empirical sciences. And the third bullet is that this brings us a step closer to achieving cooperative behavior among robots and humans. Historically, I have to play a sage at this point. And Einstein noticed that there were two major advances to Western science. One is the development of logic by the Greek. The second one, the recognition by Galileo that you can find cause-effect relationship based on experiment. And I'm offering you a third one. I'm following that step and trying to combine the two, the logic of the Greeks with the experiments of Galileo to come up with logically sound theories of causes and counterfactual. And the third slide says, I told you it's easy. Our mission largely accomplished, but more to be done. And thank you.
Thank you, Professor, for reminding us that not only did science come out of philosophy, but philosophy and science continue to be highly relevant to one another. As a token, the small but relevant token for your talk, the conference here would like to present you with this token.
Thank you
again.